Okay. All right. Hey, everybody. I'm Eric. I'm making a game. It's called The Godkiller. It's a 3D top-down puzzle-solving adventure game. Been working on it for about a year and a half. I'm either 40% done or 80% done. One of the two, depending on how you do the calculations. So, just to start out, if you want to get your point across to somebody, if you really want it to stick, you got to say the same message three times. I'm holding up three fingers. Okay, good. So I thought maybe I had the wrong number of fingers up. Okay. And why? Because, I mean, you could just say it one time, but chances are they're not paying that close of attention. Second time, most people get it, but if you really want to be sure, three times. Okay. You say, well, why not four times? Now there's diminishing returns. You know, you spend all your time repeating yourself. Eventually you'll have no time for nothing else. But three times, get that message to people three times. It's the magic number. But you don't want to do it artlessly, you know? So if I say, have a glass of water. Have a glass of water. Have a glass of water. Okay, that's too much. Feels pushy, insults the person's intelligence. They didn't hear you the first time. So you still need to say things three times because you want to be an effective communicator. But, you can't say it the exact same way. You could say, you should have a glass of water. Yeah, have a glass of water. What are you feeling like right now? Maybe a glass of water, okay? Or, you know, another idea I had is you could try a glass of water, okay? Also, instead of repeating, you pre-peat. So instead of saying the first thing followed by two, the same message two more times, you put those first two, you put the last two messages in front of the first, and you pre-peat instead of repeat, then that gives people a premonition that you're about to say something really good. So you say, like, have a glass of water, have a glass of water, have a glass of water. And there I pre-peated. I didn't repeat. I moved, I arranged the sequence of how I said the words in a different order, and that made it sound entirely different. So, yeah. And the other thing you can use is synonyms. I don't mean synonyms or cinnamon. I mean synonyms, which are words that mean the exact same thing, but are different words. So I could say, yeah, you need to paint my house. I could say, you need to apply colored wall coverings to my domicile. Okay? And you know, the person might end up painting my house three different times. Am charging me three times as much because I asked them three different ways, but at least I'll definitely get my house painted. So with all that important knowledge bestowed upon you, I think we should do a demo. But on the other hand, maybe that's not the right course of action. Maybe instead we should do a demo. All right. Here we go. It's demo time in the city. Will not be a demo of text. This will be a demo of sound. Okay. So let's hit the play. I'm gonna crank the volume a little bit so you can properly hear this. You won't hear me as much. You'll hear the sound, and that's good for some people. To hear less of me.
Good for some people.
To hear less of me.
Good for some people. To hear less of me. Good for some people.
Oh my God.
To hear less of me. Good for some people.
Oh my God.
To hear less of me. Good for some people.
The irony. Yeah, I accidentally unmuted something. It was a wild experience right there. But it happens to me on the regular. Okay, so we're playing. This is the game. There are many sound effects in it. I add a new type of a sound effect. So I have, I've got melodic sound effects. That's a melodic sound effect, and it will play in the designated key for the level, as will all other sounds, so that they harmonize together. Okay. Then there's some that are non-melodic. It kind of sound melodic, but the point was, it's not like a given note that plays. That was an instrument, but it wasn't melodic. So if I hit one of these guys, little drum beat there, snare hit. Okay. So that's old stuff, but I just want to kind of catch some people up on the sound effects that are in the game. Okay, here's the new one. Okay. Off to the west or left of the screen is a level exit. And I want something special for this, because this is when you win a level, right? So it's got to be good. Listen as I approach it. Very localized. Okay, it's a rolling drum, and then there's a glockenspiel, which is a little tiny bell, makes a ding 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 ding, that type of thing. Okay, it's the first looping sound that I've made in the game, so this will loop. It'll play indefinitely, and then I'll show you what happens, how the sound changes when I step onto the level exit. Okay, so now you're seeing another level that loaded, which looks something like the first, but there's some small differences. It's actually a copy, and the line weight settings weren't copied over from one level to another, so it looks weird, okay? But the key thing is it loaded a second level. That little song was playing the whole time, song I wrote last night after I got off the stream. I'll do it one more time in this sort of alternate reality version of that same level I was at. So that's the demo. It also leads into what I'm going to work on in the session today. So you notice that after I've already gotten to the other level, the song is still playing. It continues to play really a pretty long time. the amount of time it will take to load the levels is going to vary. So I sized that song, I made the duration of that song for the pessimistic case that it takes a very long time. And I thought, like, I will just have the song end as soon as you start the next level. But I like the song so much. Maybe I'm just biased because I just made it, but because like right after I make a song, like it sounds like it's just a world beater to me, and then after a bit I'm like, okay, it's all right. But I think it works as a bridge between the old level and the new. So what I'd like to do is, when you arrive at the new level, that little song will just fade out pretty quickly, maybe 1 or 2 or 3 seconds. And, you know, like I said, it might take varying times to load the level. Could be 3 seconds, 1 second, 10 seconds. And that sample, I think, is maybe 20 seconds long. So I just need a fade out capability. Now this is also true of another set of sound effects I have. The fling guide. These pink dots that go out in all the directions to show you where you'll land when you fling yourself. When I let off the key, they just instantly stop right now. It feels too abrupt. It feels graceless. Artless. My new favorite word. Wow. Military plane flew by me. So that same fade out capability, I want to be able to use it on this fling guide sound effect as well. So I'd like to generalize it. I'll just say, for any sound effect, instead of just saying stop, you can also say fade to silence after X seconds. And then I won't have to worry about updating it after that from the calling code. It'll just be handled by the sound effects class or some other kind of mechanism that is totally separated from the calling code. So I have that general capability, and I think it will serve me well immediately for those first two sounds, but then also for other things later on. It'd be nice to have that capability to just say fade it out and then let this other already written code worry about it instead of whatever the calling code is that's trying to handle something. So that's what I'm doing on this session, and it's going to be Unity coding, C# coding, and it's probably going to be a couple hours. Here we go. You should really have a glass of water. Water is what you should have. When I think of the things you could put inside of you right now, water is my best recommendation. Please. All right, enough nonsense. It's a limit to the amount of nonsense that people can take. Let me think, what is the best way to accomplish this? So is there a stop on this? I don't. I guess I'm returning the audio source. I'm letting whoever called it control the audio source. That's okay. Let me see if that's what I did with the fling guide. That's what I did. I just said stop. Okay, so let me think of some different ways to do this. I like to do a little pocket design, which is where I put temporarily a little bit of commenting in my code to figure out which of a number of approaches I want to take. So my requirements. First, I write my requirements. It's very formal, this process I have. Fade out a plain sound. Without calling code managing the fade out. Right. When fade out is completed, plain sound should stop. So my first number one idea, sound effect, fade out, duration. The trick here is that there has to be something that gets called on the update frame that repeats the whole fade out thing. I mean, that reduces the volume on the audio source so that you hear the fade out. I think this is not quite the best way. I don't know if it really helps anything to have this interface up in sound effect if it's not actually going to be doing the work. So typically I call sound effects and then whatever the sound action is that I want. So I think I've got one for exit, so we could say fade out exit. Okay, and inside of fade out exit, it's going to know more specifics about what should happen. Sound effects knows what needs to happen for individual sound effects, like if they should be positional, what should affect their volume, things like that. Let's see. I don't need it to be a fade transition. Let's call it audio transitions. Okay, so sound effects keeps a list audio transition. Or maybe trying to generalize where I can, so I have to keep on inventing new things all the time. Changes to just sound. Number two, I already immediately like better. And I'm pretty sure it's what I'm going to do. Let me design this I sound transition. I think it is. Turn true if sound is still playing, False, if not. It's very similar to the interface I have for effects. Okay, what is fade out sound transition? Like, let's see. Auto source duration float duration. That's it. Perform gets. Need to also store the start time. Yeah, it can get it itself. It can just call time.time and get it that way. That's simple enough. Okay, I think this is it. Let's call this number one. I actually think there's a problem with what I put there. Same as number one, but to avoid allocating frequent after scene mode, no iSound transition. Just one sound transition class that has transition type, start time, audio source, duration. That's better because I can allocate the list one time. I can pool it basically. So I believe with Unity. Allocate a list to an initial size, and then I can add and remove elements from it. Let me get this data structure down. Also, I just need more water. I'll be back. And that's not joking around. I really do need some water. I'll be right back. I promise. You know what I'll be very soon? Back. You know, I've never had a refrigerator with an ice maker before. It is super glamorous. Ice maker, ice maker, I make as much ice as I want. Infinite ice. Okay, let's get to work. Quit screwing around. What is wrong with me? What's wrong with me? Okay. What kind of data structure is this? So a list is fine. I just have to reuse elements in it instead of adding more elements. Because even if you've got a list and it's pre-allocated, if you're adding elements to it, the adding part doesn't by itself force an allocation. But if you have to say the thing that you're adding will be newly constructed, if you're doing list add new sound transition, well, then the allocation is happens here when you do the new sound transition, but not here, assuming you pre-allocate the list. Like if you did list equals new list three, you know, something like that, then you're good for no allocations on the add up until you've added more than three. So this has reminded me a lot of some other code out who wrote. I'm gonna go on to number three. This one is a little bit dubious. Let me just type it out and I'll refine it, or I'll delete it if it's just garbage. Use audio point pool to track to hold transition info. The advantage of that is audio point pool is a pool. It already has code inside of it to find the audio transitions and reuse them. Okay. As a class, audio point, which could be extended to include more information in it. Okay, let's keep fleshing this out. It might be good. this isn't quite it. Okay, this one is the least work. Okay, this is a little bit better. Let's see, it maintains a list audio point. All audio points that have transitions. Okay, so this is what I was talking about before. If the audio point itself that comes back, if I don't have to say new audio point, then me putting it into a pre-allocated list is not going to allocate memory, as long as I don't go past the list allocation when I do my add. Okay. Let's say this is number four, same as number three, but audio point pool keeps list of audio points with transitions. Okay. So thinking about these five different options, all of them are viable. You got pros and cons. The first one is really very OO, and it'll be nice and simple to read the data structure, which tracks the transition. But I don't like performing continuous allocations. I made that mistake on the effects. I hope I don't have to go in and rewrite the effects. I'll do, you know, performance optimization later and see if it matters. But I'm going to axe this one because I don't want to have a continuous allocation. So I use that pattern that I just deleted for the effects. So I've got, you know, one class for each type of effect. And that's a nice sort of OO object-oriented way of doing it. Because like when you go into axle rotate blocked, the information that's here is only about this particular effect, but it inherits from this effect here. So somewhere else I've got a list of effects, and they're not a list of, okay, I have a list of effects and I can call the common interface on each of them. When I want to update all the effects, the common interface is this method called perform. That's very nice and clean, but performance-wise, it sucks. Or at least people tell me it does. I'll check and see what the actual trouble is that's caused by it. Okay, but if I was doing it over from scratch, I would not have this polymorphism feature in play here. This thing where you derive different classes from a base class and put them all on a list, because it means I have to continuously allocate new objects and put them in the list. If I had one single effect class object, it would be its own kind of mess, but it would be more performant because then I could say, well, it's just a pool of effects, and we'll just reuse those same effects again, just overriding them with different values to avoid allocating new objects. But in order to do that, I have to have some kind of class that serves all the different effects. Or if that's too much, then I might make groups of different types of effects that tend to have the same types of parameters to them and the same kinds of concerns. And then I create separate lists for each type of effect. Like there might be a class of effects that's all for moving transforms around. But anyways, that's one problem that I've, one mistake I've already made in my design that will be expensive to fix, and hopefully I won't have to fix it. So I'm looking at my sound transitions and thinking like, I'll probably have a fade in. What else might I have? I might fade in and out in different ways, like using logarithmic or exponential curves. Yeah, I expect 2 or 3 or 7 types of audio transitions. But they all should be pretty close in terms of what are the parameters that go into them. So I don't mind using one class to represent different types of sound transitions. Okay. So then the problem becomes, where to put these audio transitions. So if I put them inside of sound effects, I end up duplicating a lot of the same code and the same data structure as I already have in another class called Audio Point Pool. I'm pretty sure I don't want to do that, so I'm willing to take out option number two. I mean, in general, when you're duplicating code, writing more code, and you don't have to write more code, it's not a good thing to do. It's not even like exactly duplicating the code, but it's definitely writing very, very similar code. Okay, so the remaining options assume that I'm going to store data in the audio point class for an active transition on the sound effect that's playing through that audio point. An audio point is my own container class for an audio source. So then, a couple other sort of deciding questions here. Do I want audio point pool to handle the transition or not? I do have inside of sound effects some code already that performs updates to sounds in response to different events. It might be a little confusing to also have code inside of audio point pool that's performing these updates to audio sources or setting volume and pan on the one I just added, basically. When you walk close to the exit, sound effects class will update the pan and volume. Probably going to be some more things like that too. So if I've already got sound effects updating, sound and volume, and that code isn't appropriate to move in the audio point pool, then it makes me think the real home of this control code should be inside of sound effects. I don't think it's settled, but I'll just say that it is a plus sound effects handles already handles volume pan updates, so it's easier to understand if all of that control code is in one place. Okay. Oh, I think I put this in the wrong spot. Move this down to here. Okay. So this one here, or these top two, they assume that audio point pool will perform the changes to volume needed for the transition. It could be other types of things are updated too. It could be pan, for example. So a type of transition I could see adding would be like a sound that the intent is to have it move from one side of the screen to the other. And then that would be updating volume and pan. Okay, so of these two options, I can eliminate one of them. So this first one is simpler code, but it's going to not be as performant. So it will have to look over 40 or so audio point objects and say, okay, which ones are playing and have a transition? And it's going to have to do that because there's no index into, you know, the sound effects that have an active transition. So number four is the same as number three, but it adds that index so it can be performant. Just merge number four into number three. It keeps an index of list audio point of active transitions. That's basically, that is number four. Okay. So the plus here. No, I don't know if there is a plus. I was going to say there's less code changes, but it seems about the same. I think the plus is, maybe easier to understand that audio point pool acts on data stored in audio point. That's shaky though, it really is. It's gotta be number five. It's number five. That's the way to do it. Okay, so this is how I arrive at decisions many, many times. Now when it comes to, like, you know, what kind of toast do I want to eat? Is it going to be avocado toast on sourdough? Is it going to be English muffin toast? No, I wouldn't write out a pocket design for toast. But for something a little more complex than that, I certainly would. Damn, I'm a thirsty boy. Okay, hold on. Be right back. I did go for a big sweaty walk. That's probably it. Well, if I'm doing good, man. How you doing? I gotta show you something. Come on, where's Unity? There we go. Okay. So, after I stopped the stream, I did a little more work and I added a song to the level exit. I'll show you. It ties into the work I'm doing right now. Volume probably went way up there. I'll turn down a tiny bit. Song. That's it. Since now I'm writing some code to fade it out. Thank you, sir. Alright, so I got this audio point thing. I'm gonna create like a new. Yeah, it's kind of simple and nice. I think I'll put this in its own file. I don't think it should be a struct. I did when I wrote it, but I'll probably be better off without it being a struct. I think that'll do it. A weird indent there. I kind of wonder though if I need this transform. Let me check. If
For a while, I was going to use that positional audio with 3D sound. I decided, I'll do my own positional audio. It'll be a little simpler and easier to control. So here I'm saying, set this, and I'm saying the parent. Question is, do I ever come back to use this transform again now that I got rid of built-in Unity 3D sound? Nope, looks like not. So I can just go. Both this stuff is going to happen inside of the sound effects class. So I'll move my little reference notes over to there. Believe it or not, right before you got here, I came up with 5 different ways to do what I'm going to do. I went through and chose the one I liked best. Number 5. Okay. That's done. Let's go back to the audio point pool. Have it return an audio point instead of an audio source. Which is it's a encapsulating class for the audio source, but now other things as well. Oops. Oh yeah, we gotta do. I think it's time to make this drier. All right, Walif. Enjoy your sleep. Nice to see you. That's not so bad. Just say bam. Okay, cool. this looks right. Move back here. Is there an error inside of here? Looks like there's a bunch of errors. Oh, yeah. Just give it a good starting number. Actually, I could use a constant from audio point pool. Fixing one thing on the broadcast.
Hey, thank you guys again. Oh my gosh, dimed. Dime donated a dollar chat. Hey bro, been watching you since.
Kinda hate how going to Twitch always has them start playing something that I have no interest in. Always it does that. Always. That's all right. Okay. Laying the groundwork here for transitional effects to be applied to my sound effects.
Thank you.
Let me name this a little bit better. So, start exit approach should start at plane, but there's conditional logic in here, which is really about updating it after it's already plane. All right, so that's how we do it. Kind of bad feeling about accessing it this way. It'll work. Turn off some of the autocomplete business in Writer. It's not saving me time. It's making bad guesses on many, many things. Let me just see if this is incorrect. Let's see. Yeah, okay. So something like a deck. It's not really a Unity question, it's a C-sharp question. This is C and C plus. Okay, let's try Q. So I think I still want list, but I want to be able to remove at. So then the other thing is, C sharp list. Yeah, versus array. Okay, so this is what I was trying to get to, is, are we talking C sharp? Yeah, .NET, okay. I thought maybe underneath the hood was implemented as a linked list. And if that was the case, then the random access speed I would expect to be very bad. But a linked list is typically good for removing elements. It all depends on how they implemented this thing. This is a good table. So what I need to do is append and remote and random access. Apparently it's really slow to call that. Typing code that I already wrote. Okay, let's do that there. Then I subtract one from I and continue, so that the next iteration won't skip over one of the transitions. Oh, goddamn hiccups. First I was really thirsty, and now I just want to get rid of my hiccups, so I'm going to get some more water. Okay, so that removes it. Let's do okay, so then I want to handle the type of transition. So let's go float elapsed equals. I think all the transitions I have will be like this. Audio point, start time. Let's do. Make sure it stopped. Okay, now if I'm still here, let's move any. Transitions that have completed. Okay. Update sound for transition. If I need the start volume. So let's add that. I think that's it. Okay. I can find the rest of my fixes with compile errors. I think I want to move all that logic I wrote into sound effects. So let's change this to something a little more unassuming. Thank you. Okay. I think I'm fine with this. Okay, let me see if I've got a clean build. Feels like there's going to be at least one big problem here. Might give it a 41% chance of working the first try. Something didn't work. Divide by zero. So what did I change here? I thought this was pretty safe, but apparently not. So before I was setting the transform. Okay, that's fine. Is there confusion about which transform I mean? Is there, will this have a transform bootable? It might. Yeah, let's call this audio point transform. Then the line it was complaining about. This one here. Object reference not set to an instance of an object. Okay, this one first. I think I might be seeing something off. It looks like the breakpoint. Oh, no, it's okay. All right. Pool count 80. Cool. Non-null. Good. Set the parent. Okay, audio source here is null. That's fine. But this should not be null. And we'll do a get component for audio source. This should be fine. Okay. What? I don't get it. What did I just look at? I know that audio point transform was non-null. Let's just break this down into an extra line. Okay, so audio source. I do like the recommendation here. I can add it to the instantiation. Just have it get set there. It does mean I've got to, I think, pick a form. Okay, now this is probably all right. Just do game object transform. Okay. That's probably fine. Okay. Non-null. Thank you. This is okay. That's okay. Okay, that works. Okay, what I do I have? I is 0. Okay, this is probably null. It is. Okay. So I lost. I lost something that set that there. So that's fine. Let's go ahead and exit out of there. Stop. Save this new audio point. While I'm at it, transition type, just to be safe, do that. Feel a lot more confident about that. fact, I'm going to put this in line again. There we go. Give this a 53% chance of working. I mean, I think I'm past the audio point problem. Oh. Oh. It's not playing anything. Well, that's no bueno. Okay. No errors in the console. Let me turn off this maximize. So, audio point pool. Breakpoint there. Give this a 0% chance of working the first time because I haven't changed anything yet. Okay. So, does it return an audio point? Good. Audio source is populated. Looking good. Volume should be 1. Yep. Pitch can be whatever. But no, this is important. It's 1, okay. So no modification to pitch. Pan should be 0. Loop should be false. Clip should be populated. I mean, okay, I gotta look at that one. I mean, this is looking right. So what's going on? I don't know. Nothing obviously wrong. I do kind of wonder if I've got some code somewhere that's stopping it from playing. Did I just turn the volume really low? No, I don't think so. Hear something playing elsewhere on my computer to prove. Oh. I apparently lost my overall. Audio. Okay. So on this computer, I'm not playing any audio at all. That's probably broadcast related. Hold on, I'm gonna turn AirPlay off just for a moment, which is going to make the screen you're seeing not be live. Okay, now my sound's back. So there was a broadcasting problem. Let me stream it back again. See if AirPlay is going to figure out what's up. There we go. Okay. Okay. Here comes the moment where I hold down the shift key and make the fling guides go up. Something wrong there. Something definitely wrong there. The pitches were off. All those code changes I did. All those code changes. But anyways, let's see what else might be wrong. See some errors. Let me fix them all one by one. So direction gets passed in, and it's this. Set a breakpoint there. Okay, so here it's saying direction negative one getting passed in. Okay, so the calling code is wrong. Convert this in the opposite direction. No, but don't do that right now, not in the debugger. Okay, hit play. Turn this off. Okay, the other thing that's wrong is the pitch. I'm guessing some of the I'm guessing some of the code I changed is wrong. But how did it work before? Okay, so back. This code's probably correct. I'm saying play at, and then I go into sound effect, and I look at play at, there's play note at. Okay. So then if I go and look at play note at, pass in the pitch here. So then let's look at audio point pool play at. Do we have anything mixed around? No. It's almost certainly going to be some problem with the glue. Let's set a breakpoint here and try it out. There's another error here. Let's see what that is. When I remove, I also need to subtract count. Okay. So the question is it passing some pitch? Okay, I'm gonna just look. It is passing pitch, but maybe it's not the right pitch. One means don't make an alteration. Question is that correct for this note that's playing? Note is 5. Okay, that's at 1. Okay. Okay, so that one is correct to not have a pitch applied to it. So let's play. It'll do another one. And this one, what's your pitch? Still 1. Okay. So then let's look at the collar again. Note I 5, still 5, which is going to be correct. Do me another one. Pitch. Okay. Still 5. Finally, a different note. No? I think I'm wrong. Well, it is a 2. Okay. Dang it. This one is also, it needs no interpolation. Let me double check that. How am I supposed to see what the problem is? Okay, that might have been correct that time. volume is too loud. I can tell that. Well, it might just be because I got the volume turned up really loud. Oh, I think I heard a trail off. Got a trail off. Oh, that's so nice. It's fading out. There we go. Okay, so the next thing to do is to add the fade off for the level load. Okay, so if I go to, what should it be? Should it be board loader? Okay, one is level start effect. Oh, this is a meta effect. Hold on. Level start effect. Let's see if this works. If it does work, it'll also be a great vindication of an earlier decision I made, which was to move all the sound effects into all the sound effect playback into objects which are not destroyed when the scene loads. Oh, but wait a minute. I put my audio points in there. But I don't know about sound effects. Sound effects aren't bootable, are they? Okay, I already know this isn't going to work. Because I'll lose my static variables. How does this stuff work when I go from one level to the next? I would have thought that all these static variables would go away. How does this even work? Alright, I'm just gonna try it. I give it a 17% chance of working. I'm really more just running it to see if I can learn about what's gonna fuck up. Regressed here. No, it's still going. How the fuck did it work? Okay, there's some other stuff down here. What? I do not know what this is about. It's not in my call stack. I'm pushing more GUI clips than I'm popping. Make sure they are balanced. Okay, maybe my understanding of static variables was wrong. Oh my god, it was a hummingbird. It was up in the sky, it was really glorious. I'm starting to think that the static variables stay there, but it's the scene objects that disappear, and that was probably what, like all the transforms and stuff, and that was probably making me think earlier that it was static variables in general, but it's really just references to scene objects, which would make total sense. Okay, I don't know, you know, this guy's code just. Thing is, I don't actually have a. I didn't introduce a GUI operation. It's not a GUI thing. There's no. And this is, again, it's not in my call stack. I don't know if this has anything to do with the code that I wrote. Okay, there's some glitchy things. I don't know if they have anything to do with the code I just wrote, but what I set out to do is done, and that means it's time to end the session. But you know what? Let's just do one more little victory lap. I'm gonna go and maximize and play my little song again. I'm gonna save everything. I know what I'll do. I want to make that trail off a little bit quicker. It does not seem quite right to me. Feels a little too much. Holding on too long. So let's go to sound effects. And then make this 0.2. Fifth of a second. Issue there. I may not be done. So the problem is if I let go of the key immediately after I fling, it's got that extra whomp, which is it trailing off it's it trailing off for the very, very start of the next fling guide. But it's pretty common. It's pretty common to let go of the shift key almost every single time, actually. Let go of the shift key after you press the arrow button. It's pretty impossible not to do it the other way. Like you have to precisely time it. So there's always going to be 99% of the time the shift key is still going to be on after arriving. So I need to I need to be able to silence very quickly without the trail off, or at least just like a really super short trail off. If you let go of the key. If you let go of the key within a certain duration. Okay, I know I can do it. It's basically exactly what I said. So inside of sound effects, Actually, it was better how it was. This here. say audio point, audio source, stop. Okay. Still playing. Turn it off, turn it off, turn it off. You'll just fail. Okay. Cool. Okay. Player guide. Here I want to know how long have those fling rays been up. There is a delay here. It isn't it. This will start them playing. What is the delay? 0.2 seconds. And isn't this what starts it playing? Yeah, so there already is a delay. Two tenths of a second. Maybe that's just not enough of a delay to pull your finger off in time to stop that second sound effect. Okay. It's tricky getting this stuff right. Call this fling full delay. Let's make it a half second. Let's describe what actually this corresponds to. Reflinged. It's called predicted reflinged delay. What's this one? Actually, I think it's onboard change it's calling it. So that constant that I wrote may not be important. This is a really nice preview feature they've got here. This is really nice. So here I'm going to say, it might be as simple as this. I might not need that constant at the top. True. I mean, yes, faded out. Here I'm going to say false, because I'm pretty sure onboard change is the thing that happens after I do the fling, which should hide the fling rays. If that's true, then let's yoink that. Okay, now let's try it again. Yes. Dang it! I might still need that little delay. No, something's off. Weird. I thought it was doing it right below, and now it's not. Be frame rate dependent. So when I go up higher, there's more geometry beneath me. tends to slow down the frame rate a little bit. Yeah, I'm hearing a tiny little bit there. Okay, I think I need that extra delay after all. So then, before I write a big long description of it and everything, and let's make sure it actually works. So where is this? Okay. Equals and let's make sure it's actually coming in here like I think it is. Maximize on play. Let's get some debug log around the other case. On board change. Okay, so this should be. Two places that will hide the fling rays. Okay, let's try that. Kind of creeps me out to see this run in the editor. Okay. So there's two of them. There's two of them here. Both of them get called. Okay, there's the order of it being called as well. On board change gain called after hide fling rays will stop it abruptly. Fade out equals fall. So look at onboard change again. guess one thing I would have thought is it should reset the state. It did. State equals state inactive. Then when update is called, these things get updated. So if I say fling guide active, okay, I come down to here. Okay, this will change it to fling guide visible. Fling guide activation time was set up above. Is that true? Yeah. But you know what? The fade outs here are all false. Like every single one of them. So if the fade outs are all false, I think one of the things is if I fling before the guides are playing their note, then I don't get the sound. No, it's still okay. What causes that to play? There, it's doing pretty good. Oh no, I'm not getting a repro now. And I'm a little bit skeptical that the delays, the lagginess of the broadcast is messing up my perception of what's going on. So that's a stream. I hope you enjoyed it. I did what I said I was going to do, and you should say some things that you're going to do and also do them. Stopping the stream